here with a little bit update slash announcement before the video. If you want to skip past this, I'll put a timestamp somewhere on the screen. If you're a regular of the channel, though, I do recommend stick around and listening to it. Not sure how long this is going to go, but that's the whole reason for the timestamp. Anyway, so you guys know the top 5 lists that I've been wanting to do on the channel now for about maybe, I want to say 2 weeks. You know, I've been putting them in the community polls, you know, for the user selected videos. Obviously, once I get ideas running, the polls will be back up. It's just that this week I didn't really know what to put on them, so it turned out to be more of a suggestion box than a poll. But you know, we worked through it. I'm gonna get started on those top 5 videos next week, the top 5 position ranking vids, and I will also have a kind of like a 5 players I expect to break out in 2020, just general NFL wise video out. I'll stick to the top 5 position rankings. The only kind of, you know, list type of video that wasn't a position ranking was the one I just said. If you guys have any other ideas like that, let me know in the comments of that video when I let that out. I'll try to get started on that one also this week, but I'm not sure. But the top 5 position rankings will start next week, and I'll release one, you know, I'll release them once a week. Hopefully I get through all of the position rankings. And also in terms of live streaming, I'm not sure if I put this on the community post yet, but you guys know that tune into my live streams. I want to do a predict the NFL for the entire NFL, all 32 teams, all 16 weeks for each of those 32 teams, a live stream prediction video where you guys will be predicting with me how these, you know, team seasons are gonna go. We're just gonna go to one of those websites where you could kind of select the winners week in, week out, and we're gonna do that. I'm probably gonna try and get one of those up this week. It's gonna definitely be more than one stream. Gonna start it this week, so make sure you tune in for that. Oh yeah, the call-in shows. I want to get those started by next week. I still have to work out the technicalities of them, but we'll have call-in shows eventually. I want to get that in there to have you guys actually call into the show, give me your thoughts and whatnot. Working on that also. So to kind of wrap it up, top 5 lists will be starting next week, but top 5 breakout players I want to get out by the end of this week. On the live streaming end of things, call-in shows I want to get started next week, and then predict the NFL live stream will be started this week.
What's up, Giants fans, Hub watchers, YouTube subscribers, Twitter and Instagram followers? It's Noname, and welcome back to another user suggested video. I keep saying user suggested. I don't know why. The correct term should be subscriber selected. I don't know. User just popped into my mind for some reason because you guys are using the channel for your entertainment, I guess. I don't know. You guys know what I mean. This week I was kind of out of ideas. Usually I would do a poll. You know how it is. The first one was the NFC East prediction video. The second one was predicting the stats video. This one, I just kind of drew a blank around the time I usually posted the poll. And even now, I'm not sure what I would have put on there. So I just turned it into a suggestion box. You know, I think this is how it's going to go moving forward. If I have a couple ideas I want to address, it will be in poll format and you guys will select which one you like best. Otherwise, it's going to be in the suggestion box format and we'll just take whichever comment either... I wanted to go whichever comment got the most likes, but every single comment got either 1 or 2 likes. So I'm just gonna go with whichever one I like the best. I hope you guys are all right with that. So let's get into it. Here was the winning comment. It was by Jack Latch. It says, 5 remaining free agents the Giants should sign. And this was actually a day before the whole Aldrick Rosas situation. So I already liked it before then, and after the Aldrick Rosas situation, I like it even more now. So this is the one I'm rolling with. And let's get right into it. So the Giants right now, as you know, with basically every other team in the NFL at this point in the offseason, everybody, you know, they're short on money. Their cap spaces are a little tight because it's after the main period of free agency, that first wave and even second wave, to be honest. I think we're in what most people would define as the third wave, which is really the summer, you know, like July, August, where there's not that many people even on the free agent markets. And there's probably like one big person out there, of course, the big person being Jadeveon Clowney, who's been somebody I've talked about heavily on this channel about possibly coming to the Giants. But every team is short on cash, and every team, usually they still pick up a little bit more players to try and fill in holes on their squad. And Gettleman in this offseason, he's done a pretty good job of filling the holes, especially through the draft. I've said it on draft night, and I continuously have said it since then for about 2 months now. The Giants had a really, really good draft. Then he had an underrated free agency also. While he did not get the players that people wanted, or the players that most people wanted, he still tried to fill in the holes. He tried to fill in the middle linebacker hole, the missing number one corner, even went out there and got a veteran swing tackle, tried to address the pass rusher. And what he did was sign these guys to smart short contracts. You know, the longest contract we gave out was a 3-year deal. And until these guys hit the field and they hit the ground running, which God knows how they're going to hit the ground running with this weird offseason, we don't know how many of the holes are actually filled in. And there's still a few glaring ones on the Giants, the two most notable being the center position and the edge rusher. So with that being said, let's go ahead and look at a couple guys they could look to sign in the remaining period of the offseason to try and get these holes fixed. And these are in no particular order, but the first player I got is the center from Seattle, Justin Britt. Now, Justin Britt is an interesting player, really, as any player on the Seattle Seahawks. Usually they, at least with their offensive line, what they do is they try to draft players at one position and move them around until they fit. Britt was brought into the league as a tackle for Seattle, bounced around a few times at guard and even left guard before he found his place at center in 2016. And in fact, when he did find his place at center in 2016, he was a solid starter, so solid that he gained a Pro Bowl nod. Now, as we all know on the Giants, the center position is definitely a question mark right now. The one person that seems to be slated in to start week one, and honestly the one person that I think will start week one, is Spencer Pulley. The Giants did let go of John Jalapio, their former starter at center. Pulley we brought on in 2018. He started a couple of games for the Giants and performed okay there, but he's definitely not a player you want to start for 16 games. He's the definition of a great backup in Spencer Pulley here, somebody that you can rely on to start for your team for like 4 to 5 weeks in a season whenever the starting position goes down. But he's not somebody that I would trust for a full 16 games. And he is the one with the most experience though, and definitely the guy that I would trust the most out of anybody else in that offensive line group to start at center position right now, unless they do something crazy like shift Kevin Zeiler over to center. The guy behind Spencer Pulley is presumably would be Shane Lemieux and Nick Gates, both of them who are not centers at their position right now. Kind of like how Justin Britt was a tackle, Nick Gates is a tackle, and he's even played some guard for the Giants, but we've all heard about the rumors and the whatnot that he might be shifted over to center, that they're trying him out at center. And Shane Lemieux, while drafted as a guard and played as guard in Oregon, has more than enough potential to make that move to center, and has even been practicing center drills and practicing at the center position before he was drafted, so he could be a future starting guy at that position for the Giants. But Justin Britt here, we're talking somebody that has been in the center position for years now, a tenured veteran in the league, a Pro Bowler that could come in for the Giants and start. Now, he got released from the Seahawks, but it was definitely because of his injury more than anything else. He had an ACL tear midway through the 2019 season, which allowed him to miss the rest of the season, and then the Seahawks released him. But assuming he somehow, some way has a great recovery season, or just even a good recovery offseason, you know, his surgery goes through well and he recovers just fine, he's not putting too much pressure on the leg with the ACL tear. And of course, the Giants will have to do their part in trying to get, you know, a medical team out to him, or try to test him in all the medical ways that they need to. Given the current pandemic situation, he should be good to go at the 2020 season. Now, I'm a believer that players, they truly bounce back from an ACL injury in their second year of recovery. That's not to say they're absolutely terrible their first year, though. They're still pretty good. And why not go out and get a veteran center that was good enough at one point to be in the Pro Bowl and was, you know, a mainstay on that Seahawks offensive line? Why not go out there, get him to be your next starting center, even if it is for half a season? Maybe he comes in, he just takes over for Spencer Pulley, and, you know, whoever battles out for that backup position eventually makes it all the way up to a first string position, then takes over somewhere down the line. You could also do that, throw him in there as a body. Now, this next one, I'm not sure how people are going to feel about, because it's going to be a wide receiver. And I've been on record saying I think the Giants wide receiving core is more than good enough to, you know, go into this 2020 season and have a good season with Daniel Jones. I think this is a wide receiving core that he can work with, and I think that we don't necessarily need another player in there this year. Maybe next year, when we actually try to start and make a run, should everything go right in the 2020 season, for the 2021 season, we'll definitely need another target there for DJ. But there has been a fourth target on this team, maybe third if, you know, you kind of count in the pitch counts and whatnot. Maybe he'll be rotating with a Golden Tate or something, but this is not somebody that I'm bringing in here to be a number one target. Hence why I went with this particular player, and that particular player is Demaryius Thomas. Now, before you get your arms up, yes, I know, 32-year-old Demaryius Thomas, that's kind of been a little bit of an injury-prone player. Not what he once was in his prime with Denver from 2012 to 2017 when he always averaged like 1,000 yards a season. I think 2017 was the only one where he didn't get to 1,000, and he always started 16 games during that time. He's not that player anymore. No, definitely not. His age shows it. His body shows it. But I'm not asking him to be that player. I'm asking him to be a big body, physical wide receiving target for Daniel Jones. It is something that the Giants team is missing to play alongside Darius Slayton. Darius Slayton is the only outside receiving threat that I trust on this team right now. Sterling Shepard has shown flashes on the outside, but I would love for Shepard to stay in the slot and do his damage there, because that's where his route running abilities are best used. And Golden Tate, I would love for him to stay on the team if we still had the offense that we had last year with Pat Shurmur, that West Coast style system that relies on the slot a lot and relies on horizontal passing a lot. Of course, Golden Tate does his damage in yards after the catch. He's shown on maybe a couple plays that he could be a good outside receiver, but just like Shepard, I would prefer him on the inside. So we're kind of missing that second outside guy on the team. And this is different from a signing like a Cody Latimer or like a Brandon Marshall that the Giants won corners. I'll repeat, he's not that anymore, and he'll be going up against probably number two or number three corners, but I have faith in him as that number three, number four option that's going up against the number three corner. I have faith in his experience and his knowledge that he's gathered over the years as a veteran wide receiver, one of the best wide receivers in the league during his prime, to come on and be a great number three or number four option for Daniel Jones and the Giants. And once again, the size, 6'3", is something that we definitely need. This Garrett offense needs big-bodied wide receivers, not just one like Darius Slayton, who Slayton is still growing and developing, of course, but you need at least two, man. Now, last year, you look at his numbers, you see the 36 catches for 433 yards. You think it's not that good, but considering that he played in just 10 games and it was a Jets offense that, on all honestly, was not that great and he had to adjust to, you know, throughout the season, it's kind of productive. And also, he's going to be fairly cheap. He signed basically a vet minimum contract with the Jets last year in 2019. He's going to come back for something around that or maybe even cheaper. Maybe somewhere like, I don't know, $1.2 million or something on a one-year deal. Demaryius Thomas will be a very cheap but very productive signing for the Giants. And as we all know, after the top three, the depth of the Giants wide receiving core is not that great. And you need to add them in there. You need to get quality depth after the top three. Because after Darius Slayton, after Sterling Shepard, after Golden Tate, you have wide receivers that are basically on here because of their special teams talent. Of course, we all hope that one of these undrafted free agent wide receivers really makes the cut, really just has a boost in their performance and makes the cut, maybe like a Ben Victor or somebody like that. But why not give a flyer on Demaryius Thomas and have him come in and see what he can do? Also, another quick thing to mention, our current wide receivers coach, who I think is one of the best in the league, if not the best, he actually coached Thomas and Sanders during their time with the Broncos. So if there's anybody that can try and get the best, the most juice out of Demaryius Thomas, it would be our wide receivers coach. Next up, to try and address that edge rusher position, I'm not going to go clowny because I feel like I've beaten that horse to death. And honestly, I don't know what Jadeveon Clowney is doing, man. He's turned down a pretty good deals from several teams. But let's talk about a more realistic standpoint here. Markus Golden. Now, some of you might be saying, well, Golden is still on the team. Technically, he's not. He is under that weird made of fifth tender that says unless a team signs him by July 22nd, I believe, then he'll still be on the Giants. Until then, any team can make a move for him, can make any deal and try to get him. And he'll come back on the Giants if he's not signed by the 22nd. For 110% of his 2019 salary, which puts him right around $5 million a year, which is very cheap considering what Golden did for us last year. Before I get into my reasoning as to why I want Golden back, and this is something fans of the channel know, I love Markus Golden. I would love to have him back. I've been saying this since free agency began. I first kind of wanted to say I do feel kind of sorry for the guy. He came onto the Giants last year on a low risk, high reward deal to prove himself to the NFL and to the Giants that he can be a legitimate pass rush talent to have on the team. And he did that. He got us 10 sacks. He was the first linebacker to have 10 sacks for the Giants in a long, long time. I think it's from since LT. Of course, not the first pass rusher, but first linebacker. Because the last pass rusher, and this was also technically a record, that had 10 sacks for the Giants was JPP, I think, in 2014. It might have been 2015. Either way, Markus Golden, in a way, did set Giants history in 2019 and was a leading pass rusher in the NFL with 10 sacks. And so he did set out to do what, you know, his goal was, prove to the NFL he's still a pass rushing talent, but it didn't pay off. It's very unfortunate because he's a good guy. You talk about character as well, says all the right things to the media. You never hear a peep out of him unless he's in an interview, and he seems like a really chill and fun dude to be around. And I mean, nobody's going for him, and it does make me wonder, is there something we don't know? I don't want to, you know, get all negative and say maybe there is some type of character issue we don't know about, but from all accounts, nobody has ever said anything negative about Markus Golden. So the only logical thing would be that everybody in the NFL believes he's scheme dependent, because that's when he's had his success, specifically under James Betcher and that blitzing 3-4 defense. Now, I still think it's weird that absolutely no NFL team is targeting Markus Golden. Not even somebody that wants a good rotational pass rusher is targeting him. And by all accounts, it looks like he'll be a New York Giants once again. In the case that he doesn't, though, we should still go out there and get him, because while I do think the scheme definitely helped Markus Golden out, I think it would be BS not to re-sign a player that got you 10 sacks last year, not to re-sign one of the best players on your defense last year. And I know a lot of people like to say that Golden, you know, was kind of lucky. He had a lot of coverage sacks or cleanup sacks. To the coverage sacks, I'll say our defensive backfield last year was horrendous. Not sure how you could get coverage sacks with a couple defensive backfield. Maybe you could give him one or two there. In terms of cleanup sacks, I definitely think that did play a part of it. The inside of the defensive line most definitely got pushes on opposing offensive line. But then you look at the games like the Patriots game and the I believe it was the Tampa Bay game, where Golden absolutely looked like a monster, and you can see why he got 10 sacks. The dude is a hard worker. He goes in there and he works every day. And in terms of the scheme fit, we're not running the better scheme this year, but I still think he's gonna be a great fit for the Giants, because we're supposedly, according to Patrick Graham and Joe Judge, we're supposedly going to have a very fluid defense running between 3-4 and 4-3, running between blitzing and not blitzing, depending on the opponent we're facing. So Golden should just slide right in. And to be honest with you, he's our best pass rushing option. Leonard Williams has yet to actually solidify himself as a pass rusher. And coming in, Golden is the only guy that's somewhat proven in that linebacker / pass rushing core. So the Giants, by all means, needs to go back out and get Golden. I really wanted him to get the money that he deserves. He honestly does deserve like a $10 million deal. But at the end of the day, I am a Giants fan first, and I'm not complaining if we get him for $5 million, which is definitely a bargain deal. And now the next player, and actually the last player on the video that I have that the Giants could potentially look into signing. And I know the comments said five players, you know, five free agents they can target. I really did try to look for a fifth player, and I was thinking about, you know, positions that I could look to, you know, other positions. You know, so far I did center, wide receiver, edge rusher. I was thinking about other positions. One didn't really pop into my mind. I was thinking about other players. Maybe there's somebody that I'm missing that you guys could put in the comments down below. But the final player here is a kicker. And this was definitely gifted to me with the whole Aldrick Rosas situation. I definitely think Rosas should be off the team. What he did, it's not like the DeAndre Baker situation. This is an open and shut case for Aldrick Rosas in terms of drunk driving and in a crash. I think he should be off the team. He put a lot of people's lives in danger. And it was just a stupid decision. The fact that he was driving on a suspended license. Why does he have a suspended license? That's a question that should be asked. So I think we should be in the market for a new kicker. And somebody that's kind of a no-brainer for me is Steven Gostkowski, the former New England Patriots kicker. And now he is old, but we've seen kickers kick well into their 40s. Look at Adam Vinatieri and Matt Bryant. He's not that old for a kicker. Steven Gostkowski at 36 years old. And basically anybody who watches the NFL and, you know, pays, you know, a little bit more attention to special teams knows who this guy is. He was at one point the best kicker in the league. I think in a stretch from like 2007 to maybe 2016, that 9-10 year stretch, he was definitely the best kicker in the league. Had one of the best kicking percentages in the league. Made a lot of his field goals. Had a good amount of power behind the accuracy also. Dude has a pretty good field goal percentage over his career at 87.4%. Field goal percentage, has made four Pro Bowls as a kicker for the Patriots. And is basically good from anywhere from 0 to 49 yards on the field. His 50 plus yardage is where he is a bit iffy. Then again, he was never asked that much to attempt a 50 plus yard field goal. Any good team is never in that position. And while I don't expect the Giants to be a great team this year, I don't think we're going to be kicking a lot of 50 plus yard field goals, because I do believe our offense is going to be working this year. It's a defense that needs work, but you guys already know that if you're on the channel. So this is somebody that I definitely think is a great replacement for Aldrick Rosas, but also in a way maybe even a minor upgrade. Now I say minor instead of major because he is getting older, is why I say minor, and he's not the dude he once was a couple years ago. Now I may be completely overthinking it, because once again, kickers play well into their, you know, 40s and whatnot, and this dude could just have a resurgent like no other if he comes on with the Giants. Especially when you consider the fact that he's gonna be with his special teams coach that he's had for most of the decade in Joe Judge. Now Judge is obviously the head coach, but you know for a fact he's gonna be heavily involved with the special teams, and special teams for the Giants in general has probably been the best part of the team over the past 3 years when we only won 12 games. The special teams has been more consistent than anything, always consistently won the best, you know, top 15 special teams in the league. Kicker is of course a big part of that, and you're gonna get a great replacement here, and he's gonna help keep it up, you know, with the familiarity with the coaching staff, and also because he has the experience and has the rep and the numbers to back it up. So those are four players that I think the Giants should look into, or the Giants could look into to sign with the remaining time of the offseason, with the remaining cap space, which isn't that much, and I definitely took that into account here, you know, if in case I didn't mention it or anything. Let me know what you guys think. The last two were definitely the more realistic ones than compared to the first two. I still think they should definitely look into with Demaryius Thomas, just because he's going to be really cheap and he is that big outside threat that we need. Justin Britt, in terms of center, maybe they're just going to roll with what they have. But let me know what you guys think, and I'm out. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and share. I'll catch y'all in the next one.